Welcome, LA Progressive friends and family. Dick and I are delighted once again to have a sit-down discussion with Mark Fancher, who has graciously allowed us to publish his really educational articles for quite some time. And the article that we're going to be talking about today is entitled, Is Voting for Kamala Pragmatism or Cowardice? So welcome, Mark.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for having me.
So your article, really interesting article, says although you rue another Trump administration, that your conscience won't allow you to vote for Kamala Harris because she doesn't express any great opposition to the genocide in Gaza. Would you care to elaborate on that?
I never really have an expectation that politicians of any kind are going to have the same perspective that I have down to the letter, or that they're going to share the same values that I have absolutely. And there have been many times in the past when I voted for people who, I've kind of held my nose and went ahead and cast a vote for them. But there is a limit to that. And I think that in many ways, Kamala Harris is a very personable person, a very accomplished person. It wouldn't be hard to be more competent than Donald Trump, but she's certainly that, and exceeds it in many ways. But the what seems to me to be the knowing and purposeful complicity in the genocide that's happening in Gaza, the disregard really for what that means in physical terms, for the thousands and thousands of people who've been impacted, all of that is highly disturbing to me, and it's difficult for me to cast a vote when I know that the implication of that is that I'm in some way, even if indirectly, endorsing the massacre of thousands of people.
Reading your piece, I mean, it really struck me because I know what you say is true. I just want to read a paragraph. You say, although I, like all rational people, would love to be spared another 4 years of Trump misery, I realize that spiritual warfare cannot be waged without injury or at least convenience. And I think maybe that line, more than any other line in your piece, is what struck me. Because when it's all said and done, we are all complicit in working with the United States to implement its foreign policy. And there was one part of your article that I disagreed with. You said that Kamala Harris, let me see if I can find it. That she is a committed Zionist who probably finds little fault with Netanyahu's Gaza campaign. I don't know that you can know what she finds fault with, because we have the kind of political system where we just there's no room for politicians to really be who they are just because of the way the campaigns are funded. And so we as a people, we've been negligent in correcting the problems that force our politicians to keep their mouths shut. Anyway, but I understand what you're saying, and I want the people who don't understand, talk a little bit about the spiritual warfare not being waged without injury or at least without inconvenience.
Sure. As to the point about you're right. I can't know for certain that she endorses it, but she, like all of us, is faced with choices, and it means that if she is confronted with the possibility, even as part of her job, even as part of even within the parameters of what she's allowed to do as a vice president or as a person, she can't actively oppose this. She has to, just like everyone else, make a moral choice about where the line is. That there may be some things that any of us are asked to do as part of our job where we just say, I just can't do that. This is so unconscionable. This is so horrible that I must step away from it. And I know that that's always difficult. Sometimes that's not something that people are in a position to do because they have to pay bills. They have to support children. They have to do all of those things. But when they're in that position, many times what people will do is they will at least give some hint as to the fact that they're not really on board with this. They're doing what they're doing grudgingly. That they're at least open to the possibility, if ever it presents itself, of making some type of a change. And that's what struck me so much about Kamala Harris in connection with this issue, is that it's not, I would get it if her rhetoric was such that she really did at length empathize with the people of Palestine and of Gaza who are suffering, and use whatever opportunity that she has to allow them to make their case. She would in some way indirectly say, if I'm president, then maybe we can revisit this issue. But she's been pretty solid in her ongoing statement that whenever she's asked about Palestinians in Gaza, she says, well, Israel has the right to defend itself. She says that with a certain conviction, which causes me to conclude that she really is on board with that program. And as you say, I could be wrong, but that's the inference that I draw. But as to the question of spiritual warfare, it's not something new. This is this from for as long as human beings have walked the earth, they have been confronted with opportunities, challenges, problems that require them to stand up against evil. And almost inevitably, whenever you do that, then you engage yourself in a conflict, in a battle of some kind. And the very nature of warfare, the very nature of battles, is that you trade blows, that it's not a matter of you just striking a blow against an enemy and the enemy succumbing, running away, surrendering. They hit back. And there is an ongoing war between good and evil. There always has been. And anybody who has engaged in it is aware of that fact. You don't stand up against evil institutions, individuals, or corporations, or anybody, and not expect that if you strike a meaningful blow, that they're not going to hit back. And the price is sometimes very high. In the article, I make reference even to Jesus, who in his efforts to bring about, some type of a transformation of human beings in terms of their morality, in terms of their spirituality, in terms of their approach to dealing with other people, had to pay, the ultimate price, torture and crucifixion. And if you look at anybody who has really fought really hard against the most evil forces in this world, they've had to deal with that. And so I think that unfortunately, many have become almost spoiled, I guess, in this country, in believing that we can have our cake and eat it too. That there's a certain sense of entitlement that we feel to comfort and convenience, and that part of that comfort involves being able to speak against things that we don't like, and there are no consequences for it. And so I think that when many people are making decisions about who to vote for, they're really sort of looking at it through that lens, that there must be a way that we can vote for the lesser of two evils and not really pay a penalty for what we're doing in the process of that. So I think that's essentially what I was getting at.
So I know that when Kamala Harris always concludes her talk about the Middle East or about Gaza with Israel has the right to defend itself. I always cringe. I mean, she did have a, she didn't indicate, she didn't meet with Netanyahu one time when he came over, and it was kind of a very soft suggestion that she would take a different position. But we're not really, we're not really dealing with an equivalency. Yes, Kamala Harris is not taking a stand against genocide. That's a big black mark against her. Trump, if anything, is taking less of a stand on it. He's a buddy of Netanyahu. But a vote for Netanyahu, for Trump, not only means wars in the Middle East, but it brings racism and fascism and discrimination and destruction of democracy. I mean, do you not think that he'll send the 82nd Airborne to Springfield, Illinois, and take the Haitians back to Haiti? I mean, he a vote for Trump or a non-vote against him is a vote for chaos. Do you agree with that?
And I think that because of it, it puts us in the ongoing trap that I think that the forces of evil want us to be in. And that is slowly but surely forcing us to be in the position of affirmatively endorsing evil. We have presented you with two alternatives. One is horrific, it's horrible. It is just absolute madness. And this is one which is a little bit less horrible. It's evil, but it's not as horrible as the other one. So choose between the two. And I think that what anyone who has an understanding of these things has to recognize is that this is part of the war between good and evil. And you have to be strong enough to say, I will not endorse evil of any kind. And we will let the chips fall where they may. And this is not, I think that so many believe that this predicament that we're in is a novel one. And it really isn't, which I think underscores the importance of understanding history. Back when Dr. Martin Luther King was leading the civil rights movement, the early phases of his activism were fully endorsed by the powers that be. And that was for a whole host of reasons. He was essentially attempting to break down Jim Crow. And Jim Crow, for anybody who is a person of goodwill, is in and of itself an evil thing. But for those who were more cynical, for big businesses and others, they saw Jim Crow as limiting their opportunities for profit. Because black people in the South represented a huge market that they really didn't have access to because of segregation. And so it was useful to them for the civil rights movement to succeed in bringing down those segregation signs and allowing black people to come into the stores and to buy all of these products that were being manufactured, to patronize various businesses and restaurants so that lots of money could be made. And you'll notice that during that phase of the movement, the media, Dr. King was really a media darling. That every move he made was highly publicized. Everything was on television. The most dramatic conflicts that he had, including the confrontations in Birmingham streets, were broadcast. They didn't have color television back then, but they made it as live and as living as they could make it, and as graphic as they could make it, so that everybody would sign on to his program. But Dr. King reached a point where he began to analyze the circumstances, not just of black people, but of oppressed people of all colors, of all races, ethnicities, and poverty as a phenomenon. And he connected that to what the country was doing overseas, specifically with respect to what was happening in Southeast Asia and the war in Vietnam. And so he reached the conclusion that as a moral man, as a principled man, it was necessary for him to speak out against the war in Vietnam and to speak out against greed and the injustices, the economic injustice of the capitalist system, as well as about the issue of race. And when he did that, many people don't know that he faced severe opposition from people who were closest to him. They put him in the same predicament that we find ourselves in. They told him that, look, we got a good thing going with this civil rights movement. We have other things that we need to accomplish with respect to race. And we can do that. Lyndon Johnson is on our side, and he can work the Congress. We've got these opportunities to make some further advances in the area of race. And this is a lane that you have been authorized to walk in. But if you step out of that lane, if you start criticizing the U.S. foreign policy and the war and all of those kinds of things, then everything that we fought for, all of these things that we've been building toward, are going to go down the toilet. And so you really need to choose the option of remaining silent about the Vietnam War. Just don't say anything about it, and let's accomplish as much as we can accomplish. And so Dr. King, being an honest man, being a principled man, understood that his duty to himself and to his God was to do the right thing. And so he stood bravely in New York on April 4th of 1967 and proclaimed his opposition to the Vietnam War. He challenged the capitalist system and criticized and condemned its greed. He admonished the leaders of this country and really called it, called his own country the most violent in on the planet. And then a year later, exactly 1 year later, April 4th, 1968, a bullet is placed in his head. Now, there would be many who would look at that and see, that's what you get for not choosing the lesser of two evils. That you end up getting killed, all the things that you work for go down the toilet and things descend into chaos. But if you look at the long reach of history and you look at what actually happened as a result of his sacrifice, you see that he emerged triumphant. The opposition to the Vietnam War accelerated and expanded, and that war ended. There were so many people whose level of consciousness and understanding about the system that we live in escalated and changed. The movement, in many ways, went in new directions that became more militant and more forceful. And we look back now on Dr. King and the example that he set. And we see a hero. We see somebody who triumphed even in the face of the violence that he encountered. And so I think that we all, have to look inward and say, is that the kind of road that we want to travel and remain principled and do the right thing all the time, regardless of the consequences? Or do we want to play political games? Do we want to be politicians? Even if we don't run for office, we can be politicians by compromising, by doing things that are not necessarily the right thing to do, but which might make us move forward incrementally just a little bit. And I'll tell you, the hazard of taking that approach is that that doesn't lead to permanent change. Anything that you negotiate about, anything that you compromise, can be retracted summarily. But when you stand firm for principle, when you do the right thing all the time, it doesn't matter what they do legislatively. It doesn't matter what they do with respect to policy. The advances that you make in terms of transforming people and causing people to think in new and different ways is something that can never be taken back. And you move the society forward on a moral and spiritual level in a way that you can't do when you play political games.
You make a very strong, rational and reasonable argument. My question is, I believe that the system we have benefits the few. It was intentionally and incrementally built to work the way that it does. Now, it didn't all happen in one fell swoop. There wasn't some mastermind sitting back in 1776, planning how we were going to run this thing. My concern is that in tandem, we, those of us who are people of good faith, who know that we have a rich country that has the bones to be the kind of country that would benefit so many more people than it does. But we're not working towards building the kind of infrastructure, the kind of machine that the other side has. So while your argument is rational, if we don't build something at the same time as we stand up and say, no, we're not going to buy into this lesser evils thing, is it all for naught if we don't have something to offer instead?
Yeah, it's never to stand for what's right and what's principled and correct is never something that's done in vain. And I think that the game that's played, the trick that's played on so many of us who mean well, is to eliminate from us our faith, not necessarily. I know there are non-believers. You have to have faith in order to make progress. If not faith in God, then faith in people. Faith and hope that things can be better. And so the system is designed to eliminate those things. And so what happens is that everybody sits in their own little silos, their own little houses, and they see nothing going on, no movement that's being built that can be an alternative to what we have. And they think that it's hopeless. They think that there's really nothing that can be done because nobody else is doing it, not knowing that there are so many people who are poised and ready to build something new. It's just that we're prevented through circumstance from knowing that they're there. And I'll give you a good example. I live in Michigan, and so it really sort of pioneered the uncommitted movement back during the primaries. And so, because I'm here, I heard about it. And because I have the sort of perspective that I have, I had no problem with voting uncommitted. But I have to be honest with you that when I went into the voting booth and cast that vote, I really thought, man, it's a good thing to do, but nothing's going to come of this. I was shocked, surprised, inspired by what actually happened. As a result of so many people going in and doing exactly the same thing, unaware that that type of a perspective was shared by so many people. And I think that we don't give ourselves a chance to build these kinds of movements. And so I think that the only thing that we can do is to play our role. If we know what the right thing is to do, then we have a responsibility to do it and hope that other people will do that as well. Because when all is said and done, we can look and we can see that there is the potential for a movement. There is the potential for an effort to build something that's an alternative to what we have. And I will not be surprised if after this election that there's going to be a realization of that. Because there are a lot of people who are dissatisfied, a lot of people who are frustrated. And I think that it's going to become apparent and evident when they start doing the analyses that there were a lot of people, by whatever actions they took in connection with this election, made that dissatisfaction known. And I think that that can potentially inspire the construction of an alternative movement that's prepared not only to deal with whatever current threats that we have, but to plan and to look forward to making something that's real. And I want to add this. I think that one of the other deterrents to people acting in ways that they believe are principled is fear. And I think that that's very much a factor with respect to the Trump threat. Because he is a real threat, an existential threat. There's the possibility of absolute catastrophe and chaos if that man is elected. But what we have to remember is that any time in our history when we've made real progress, those who have made it, those who have been engaged in the struggle for it, have looked at threats that were just as daunting, if not more so, and more direct. I mean, can you imagine a freedom ride, left Nashville, Tennessee, headed south, and the bus filled with civil rights workers was stopped by angry white mobs. who pull these people from the bus and beat them within an inch of their lives and set the bus on fire. Okay. And then the word got back to Diane Nash, who was coordinating the Freedom Rides in Nashville. And they asked her, they said, "Diane, all of these people got hurt. All of these people got burned. What do we do?" She said, "Get some people back on another bus and let's go." I mean, that type of courage, to say, "Look, in spite of what has happened to these people, we're going right back into the face of evil, and we're going to conquer it, no matter what it takes." I mean, you look at the decisions that were made with respect to the Birmingham campaign, and the fact that they knew that sending little children into the streets to confront Bull Connor and the police was going to erupt into a violent confrontation, and that people would be hurt, and ultimately people would be killed. But they knew that this was the price that you had to pay for freedom. And so, in spite of the dangers, in spite of the hazards, they did it anyway. That's what we have to do. That's what it takes. And I think that personally, I mean, I know everybody's beliefs are different. I don't believe that God overlooks the sacrifice that people make, and that he rewards it. The individuals who make the sacrifice may not personally enjoy it, but ultimately, over time, we triumph. Because I said, as I said in the article, you look at the institutions of evil that have existed in our history, whether it's slavery, whether it's colonialism, whether it's apartheid, whether it's Jim Crow. All of these things, they seemed at the time that they were present, that they could not be defeated, that they would be there forever. And all of them have been crushed and consigned to the dustbin of history. And that's only because people were willing to confront them with courage, and with and staying true to their principles. And that's the only way that we're going to overcome the threats that we face, whether it's the ongoing genocide in Gaza, or even Donald Trump. I mean, I come from a people who endured slavery and Jim Crow, and the truth be told, that really the people who are most afraid of Donald Trump are not people from my community, because the things that people are afraid of are things like the institution of a police state, the denial of opportunities for health care, the limitation on what you can learn in schools. And if you go into many communities in this country, that's already the reality. So Donald Trump doesn't mean anything to many of us. The only difference is that many people who have been privileged and who've been spared of those kinds of consequences now might experience what it's like to be black or brown in America.
So this moral position that you're taking, as you indicate, is hardly yours alone. I mean, I approve the comments that come to all our articles that have anything to do with Gaza or the election. And almost universally, people will take your position that Trump is a whore, but I can't go with Kamala Harris because of her lack of opposition to Gaza. I'm going to vote for Jill Stein or
Cornel
nobody at
West, oh,
all,
Cornel
or
West.
Cornel West. But I entertain the fantasy. I believe the Kamala Harris campaign realizes that she's headed for a loss. It appears that way. They try to candy coat it, but it that's the way it looks. It's unbelievable that she would lose to Donald Trump and his buddy Arnold Palmer. But I wonder if she would conceivably, I don't know that. I think she's in the middle of an apparatus. I don't know personally if she supports Zionism or not, but it's conceivable either cynically to try to win the election or just why not do it because it's, I believe she could come out and say that I'm going to move four square to end the American involvement in the genocide. I don't know if that would make a difference. I know it would make a difference with a lot of people because a lot of people are like you. A lot of people are like you, or either maybe hold their nose and vote for Harris or vote for nobody or sit at home. It's a difficult decision. More difficult than even when George W. Bush was running or Ronald Reagan. I mean, it seems like the stakes are exponentially higher this time.
I want to, that doesn't seem like that was a question. So I want to pose a question. So
Didn't say it was a question.
Mark, you're a learned man. You're a professor. Are you a professor? Do I have that right? No.
I tried that for a minute. It didn't fit. I'm just a practicing lawyer.
So you're a practicing lawyer. One element of this problem that I believe has gotten us to the place where we are is apathy and the lack of engagement of the average person. And it feels to me like, if we get into this confrontation, we somehow have got to educate the masses as to their role in helping to create this. After Dr. King died, there was a lot of movement before he was assassinated, but after he was assassinated, it was like everything just fell apart. And that's where it has remained. And Dick and I, we publish this thing every single day, and we've been doing it for 17 years. And I'm tired. And it really upsets me how few, especially of my own family, just doesn't read, doesn't. It seems to me that that's our real battleground.
It is. And at the same time, I don't think that we should misread history. It is true that Dr. King's movement fell apart, but that doesn't mean that resistance to injustice fell apart, because actually it moved to a higher level. And by necessity, everything must change, because the world changes, circumstances change. And so him staging nonviolent protests in the South was very effective in the 1960s. By the 1970s, that was no longer effective. And so, even though his movement fell apart, it's probably good that it did, because what was necessary was something that was a bit more militant. The rise of Black Power, the rise of the Black Panther Party, was just what was needed in that moment. And I think that whether it takes the form of an explicitly political movement or not, people are always resisting on some level. They're always becoming more conscious, whether we can see it or whether we can't. We can always see the manifestations of it. Okay, so Kwame Ture, who many know as Stokely Carmichael, said that one time he was approached by an elder man who said to him, "You spend a lot of time talking to college students." And he said, "Yeah, I do." And he says, "That's a waste of time, because they don't know anything. They don't know anything. They don't know anything about Malcolm X. They don't know what Dr. King did. They have no appreciation for the movement. They don't know any of the things that you did. They just don't know these things, and they're not engaged in any type of activity." And he says, "Well, you're right. They're not consciously engaged in that level of struggle and study." He says, "But their level of consciousness is far higher than the youth of my generation. The youth of my generation in the 1950s, if you asked them to step to the back of the bus, they would get up and step to the back of the bus." He said, "I challenge you, I dare you to ask a black youth to get to the back of the bus. They will not go, because the expectations are different. Their level of consciousness about what their rights are and what they should expect as human beings has changed. And those are things that continue to change. The only question is, how fast can we make the change?" And there's a whole lot more that we can do with that. And I think you're absolutely right. And it's a complicated challenge in this respect, that in many ways, across the board, poor people, working people of all races and communities have had it with the US empire. They've absolutely had it. The problem is that, particularly in white working class communities, their analysis is completely off. They don't have the information that they need in order to process accurately why it is that they don't have the health care that they need, why it is that they don't have the educational opportunities that they need, why their standard of living is worse than their parents and their grandparents. Why all of these things are going wrong. They don't, and so it makes it possible in that vacuum for a demagogue like Trump or anybody else to step in and to tell them that the reason that all of things, everything is going wrong is because of these immigrants who are coming across the border and murdering and killing and raping people, taking jobs and eating pets, right? And so they've got nothing else to latch on to. The job that needs to be done is to give them the correct information. They're ready to take they're ready to take freedom. I mean, January 6th proved that. And that's what scared the oligarchy a lot, because they knew that, these people are misguided and they're ignorant. They're making wrong decisions about how and what to do. But look at their commitment. And can you imagine what they'll do if their priorities are in order, if their analysis is correct and they're thinking in a strategic way? That's the great danger. And anybody who takes on the task of trying to educate and organize the white working class is someone who most certainly has sealed their fate, that they're doomed. And I think that communities of color likewise have a similar problems in terms of ignorance and misinformation, but it's less severe. And I think that particularly, black men have been the focus of so much attention recently because they're presumably abandoning Harris and defecting to Trump. Part of their analysis may be correct, that they don't see Kamala Harris as someone who's going to address their needs. And she's never said that she will. I mean, she's said precious little about her interest in addressing issues of mass incarceration or police violence. Or fundamental bread and butter issues that young black men might be concerned about, and so they make the intelligent decision. Well, let me abandon her, but they don't see any other alternatives, and so they say, well, let me try this guy, let me try Trump, and that's just because they don't know any alternatives. They know they got to do something. And I think that that's what gives us hope, is that as long as people know that they've got to do something, that they see the flaws in the system, they see the problems, and they know something's got to be done, then that takes us a long way down the road. We just have to be in a position to give them the correct information so that they make the correct analysis.
Well, Mark, thank you. That's a great answer. And yeah, we just got to keep keeping on. We really have to build that infrastructure, and we've got to educate the working class, white working class, black working class. All of us need to understand that we have common interests that we need to protect. And that does not involve voting for the lesser of two evils.
Okay, thank you, sir. We can't wait for your next article and interview. We'll have this up tomorrow.
Oh, thank you so much, as always. And
Thank you.
I don't know if you know how much impact you guys have, but it's quite a lot. So please continue doing what you do.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, we don't know.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.